Hare Krishna. Very warm welcome to the Ram Navami 2019 celebration. So the next item on the agenda is a katha. So as we all know, in the nine process of bhakti, listening, hearing about Krishna is very important. And Sri Ram is none other than Krishna himself. So I made a little presentation. Which I thought of making it appropriate for all ages because we have small children to grown up. So I put together a little presentation for today and hope everybody from young to old will enjoy it. As we know, Ram Katha is apar. There is no beginning, no end to Krishna Katha. So I'm just will be touching on few things, and that's all we can do in the short time that we have. So just bear with me, I'm trying to bring up the... So as it is custom, we're going to start with the invocation prayers. So we'll all stand, or I mean sit straight with your spine erect. Close your eyes, bend your head in very prayerful mood, fold your hands in front of your hearts. And you can close your eyes, or if you want to read the script, I'll be projecting on the screen so you can read. And let's pray to Supreme Lord, to the Guru Parampara, and all the Vaishnavas take their blessings before embarking on this journey of listening to Ram Katha. And whoever hears this Katha gets purified. That's guaranteed in the scriptures. So you can repeat after me in the first portion, and then we'll all recite together. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo
Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam namaskritya,
naram
chaiva narotamam,
devim sarasvatim vyasam,
tato jayamudire, nashta prayeshu abhadreshu,
nityam bhagavat sevaya,
Bhagavate Uttamashloke Bhaktir Bhavati Nashtaki
Krishnaya Vasudevaya
Devaki Nandanaya cha
Nanda
Gopa Kumaraya Govindaya namo namaha. Om Agnantim Randhasya Gyananjana Shalakhaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasme Shri Gurve Nama Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Gurun Shri Utapad Kamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamsa Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Shri Ragnatam Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakham Vitamsa He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute तप्त कांचना गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानु सुते देवी प्रणमामि हरि प्रिये चाकल्पतरुभस्य कृपा सिंधुवैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः श्री श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैता गदाधरा श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंदा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा हरे रामा राम रामा हरे 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 कृष्णा Thank you very much for so wonderfully reciting the invocation prayers. So, welcome to the 2019 Ram Navami celebration in the Vedic Center. So, I'll be asking some questions, but those questions are mainly for the Yuva devotees. And the adults can answer too, but it'll be mainly for the young people. So we celebrate Ram Navami to celebrate what? Where is Surbhi? I thought I have my point person. So why we celebrate Ram Navami, Surbhi? Yes, for the appearance of Lord Sri Ramachandra. So we call it appearance because birth is for the ordinary human beings. The Lord appears. Sambhavami yoge yoge. Right? So that's the... And why it's called Navami? Navami in Sanskrit means? Nine. So it's the ninth day of the Shukla Paksha of the month of Chaitra, which is the current month. And in this, there is a nine-day celebration also called Navaratri. So as we all know, the Navaratris happen twice in a year. One happens in the springtime, the other is in the autumn time. So this is the springtime Navaratri. And on the ninth day, the last day of the Navaratri, Ram Navami is celebrated. That's the day Sri Ramachandra ji appeared on this planet. Okay? So we know that Sri Ramachandra ji is an avatar. Avatar means when the Lord descends. Doesn't mean incarnation. It's not the exact translation. So, it's the seventh avatar. We know that there are dasha avataras, which are the principal or the main avataras. The Lord has limitless forms and appearances, but the 10 are the most important, called the principal 10 avataras or dasha avataras. And Sri Ramachandra ji is number 7. Yes. Do we know what are the first 6? Yajat, you know? I thought you almost raised your hand.
The gate is in the room.
Yes. So we have the avataras on the door. So I will speak. So one is the first is a Matsya avatara in the form of fish. And that actually is universal. You know, in other, this also, there is a big deluge and then there is a boat and people are saved. Right? Like called Noah's Ark in Christianity and other, even in Islam there is. So that is the first avatar. Then is the Kurma avatar, the tortoise, turtle. And then comes the Varaha avatar. And then comes the Narsimha. So it's an evolution, see, from the fish in the water to the tortoise, which is both in water and on the earth, to Varaha, which is only on the earth. And then comes the Narsimha, which is half lion and half man. Then comes the Vamana avatar, right? And then after Vamana, Parshuram. And then Shri Ram. So seventh avatar. So these are the principal avatars, but there are so many other avatars. So it's part of the spring festival and it's celebrated all over India. Okay? So it's not that, you know, it's in some parts or all, it's universal, it's celebrated all over the world actually. We're celebrating here in Bloomington, Illinois. And we all know that Sri Ram is none other than Krishna himself. So, and then, you know, I made a presentation and then somebody changed it to enhance it. So there are a lot of special effects that I even don't know. So I'll be going along with it. So here is Jagannath Ji, Baldev and Subhadra.
And Shyama.
Yes. 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 So it's all, see the scriptures, the Vedic scriptures are so interlinked. You'll find references of one scripture, one personality to the other, and not only in one lifetime, the previous lifetimes and the future lifetimes, because it's a continuity. It's not one birth, one life type of a deal. It's a continuum.
The previous slide was Radha
Shyam Sundar, Sita Ram. Yes. And Lakshman. Yes. So it's like a continuum. And also, everything is linked or based on spirituality. Now, I'll give you an example. I just talked of month of Chaitra, right? So the names of the months of the years are also chosen in a very systematic way. Each month has a meaning. It's not like, you know, random. Like, I don't even know what February, January means, you know. It's January is after Janus. I don't know who is February after. And why there is 28 days and 30 days and 31 days. So it's all arbitrary. But the Vedic calendar is made in a very systematic way. And each month has a presiding deity. See, for the month of Chaitra, it's Vishnu. Then Vaishakh is Madhusudana, Trivikrama, Vamana. All the different names and the forms of the Lord for all the months. And then we have a Purushottama month. Adhik month, you know, we celebrate that to make up the lost 1 month. And so I just wanted to share that. So Lord Ramchandra appeared where? Any ideas? I have to go back to Surbhi again, or somebody going to else is going to answer? Yes. Ishani has raised her hand. Huh? Yes. Hari Bol. So Sri Ramchandra Ji appeared in Ayodhya. It's in India. It's in UP, you know, current day UP, United Provinces. It used to be a kingdom, and Ayodhya was the capital of the kingdom. The kingdom name was Kaushal, and the capital was Ayodhya. It was called Ayodhya because of a very great king named Aja, who was the ancestor of Sri Ramchandra. After him, the name was given Ayodhya. Ayodhya also means, yud means war in Sanskrit. So Ayodhya is a place where there is no conflict. It's a very elevated place at that time. We can't talk of Kali Yuga. So that's why it's called Ayodhya. Now here, every time is fighting. Now, you know, a lot of fights going on. So that's where Sri Ramchandra appeared. And it's a very interesting story. And I made it a little more for children. So it so happens that there was a king at that time. His name was Dasharatha. In the bhajan, we heard the name Dasharatha, right? So Dasharatha was a very great king. He was a great warrior. He was named Dasharatha. Anybody knows why? What Dasha means? 10, right? Ratha means chariots or directions. So he was such a great warrior that he could fight in the 10 directions. In the Vedic system, the directions are 10, not 4. How 10? So there are 4 east, west, south, north, right? And then there are 4 corners. And then there is up and down. So there are 10 directions. So he could fight in his chariot, go into the sky and fight in all 10 directions. Enemies coming from 10 directions. So he was named as Dasharatha. His original name was something else. His original name was Nemi, but he was famously known as Dasharatha. So he was ruling at that time. He was a very strong king, but he had one problem. He did not have any son. So he married 3 times. thinking, you know, he'll get a son, maybe from the second wife, from the third wife. You could do it on those days, not current days. You know, you cannot do that, at least. Right. So he married three queens. Anybody knows what are the names of those queens? Now we want to give somebody else a chance. The Surbhi will be the last person to come to. She's our... Yeah. She's the point person. Subject, what is called? Expert. SME, yes. She's our SME on Ramayana. So, okay, Surbhi, so what are the names of those three queens? Very nice. Haribol. So those were the three queens of Dashratha, but he still did not have any son. He had one daughter though. Anybody knows that Ramchandra ji had a sister? Who knows that he had a sister? You are not a child. I'm asking the children. You forgot the rule. Only when children don't answer, then you answer. Yes, so there was a daughter born to Dashratha and Kaushalya. She was the eldest. Her name was Shanta. Correct. So they had a daughter. Okay? But there was no son. At that time, king had to have a son to continue the reign in the kingdom. So he wanted a son. So then he was advised by the sages. Those were the advisors and counselors at that time. And they told him to perform an elaborated yagna. You know, as we heard in the Karma Kanda, you can perform yagna to obtain any material benefits. So he was advised to perform a very elaborate fire sacrifice called Putra Kameshti Yagna, means yagna to obtain a son. And it is a very elaborate, you know, there's a lot of arrangements have to be done. And sages come and they perform procedure, goes on for a lot of time, and then you do a lot of charities and penances. And then finally, from the fire, Havan Kunda, the fireplace, a great personality appears. He is the fire of God, Agni Deva. So Agni Purusha appears from the Havan Kunda, and he had a pot in his hand. And what that pot had? Any ideas? Okay, you are a child for now. Yes, go ahead. What was it? Yes, it's called Payasam, which Kirtida Mataji actually made today, right? That's why, that's the significance why she made a Payasam today. It's called Payasam. Yeah, no, it is called Payasam. Any sweet offering is called a Payasam. So that is actually the traditional one, but it was a sweet rice or kheer or Payasam in a golden pot. So he comes and gives it to King Dashrath. King Dashrath receives it, and the instruction is go and give it to your queens, and they will all have a child. So that is a very sanctified offering that Agnideva gives to Lord Dashrath, King Dashrath, that he has to go and give his wives, and they will get son. He will get a son. So he goes. And there is a very interesting story now. This is not for exactly from Ramayana. This is a very interesting part coming in Arya right now. Very interesting, you'll like it. So, when he was taking the pot, as he was taking the pot and going towards the palace, little bit of payasam spilled from the pot. As that payasam was falling to the ground, an eagle comes flying and grabs it in his beak and flies away. Any idea who that eagle was? Very nice, Garuda. Garuda. I wish Jia was here. So it was Garuda. And now there is a reason what happened and what happened to that drop of payasam. So then Dashrath goes to the palace and gives the pot to the queens. So this is what happens. So first, from the pot, major portion is eaten by Queen Kaushalya. She was the eldest. So she eats almost half of it. And then she gives it to, actually, Sumitra. Sumitra was the youngest. because she is sitting, standing next to her, so she gives the pot to Sumitra. So Sumitra takes little portion from it and gives it to Kekai. Then Kekai takes a big chunk from it, but then whatever is remaining, she gives it back to Sumitra. So I asked Anand Vihani today how that happened, how that was divided, and she didn't know. So now here is the explanation. So Sumitra got the payasam twice. So she had twins. You know who the twins, who got who? The queens? Yes, Surbhi. Yeah, you can tell Sumitra's first. Excellent. So she got the payasam twice, so she got twins. They were not identical twins, so but they're twins. So Lakshman and Shatrughan were born to Sumitra. And who was born to Kaushalya? And to Kekai? Bharat. Very good. So that's how they got, Dashrath got four sons. But now if you think, you know, it all happened at the same time, right? But when we depict in the Ramayana or when we do Ram Leela, Ramchandra is so big and Lakshman is small and then Shatrughan is small. How that happened, right? It raises a point. They were all born. Same were, if you remember, Kauravas, the 100 of them, 100 sons and one daughter. By the way, Dhritarashtra also had one daughter. So 100 sons and one daughter, they were all almost born at one time. So this has happened even in the hospital when you get twins or triplets. Whoever is born first becomes the elder. Right? So they're all born at the same time, but not on the same day or this thing. So there's a little difference. So Sri Ramchandraji was born first, then Bharat, then Lakshman, and then Shatrughan. So that was the order. They were born, but they were almost same age. Right? So Dashrath got four sons at the same time. But we are discussing the appearance of Sri Ram. So it is said that because of the portion of the payasam they ate, so similarly they got the potency of Krishna in that proportion. So it is said half Sri Ram, then 1/4 Lakshman. Lakshman is none other than Baladev or Sankarshan. Okay? And then 1/4 and 1/4. Bharat and Shatrughan. So that's how it makes it complete. So that's how it happened. So I found that it was interesting. Now what happened to the portion that Garuda took? Any idea? Anybody knows? It's a big secret. And it was revealed last year actually in Hanuman Jayanti. Huh? So it was discussed last year. I'm giving the hint now, yes. So, okay, let's make it short. So, Garuda takes that drop of payasam and goes to a place called Anjaneya. It's a hilly place. And then there was Mother Anjana. She was in Anjaneya mountains and she was reclining and she yawns, you know, she was going to sleep. And Garuda drops the payasam in her mouth. And from her was born Hanuman. So see how things are all interrelated. So because Hanumanji is the avatar of Lord Shiva. Okay. So when Krishna comes, all the paraphernalia and all the associates come. So that's how the arrangement was made. So that was the birth of Hanumanji, and you can say the Hanumanji also contemporary, born at the same time, right? So then we hear a lot about Shri Krishna when Shri Krishna was to appear in the prison cell in Mathura, right? Because Mother Devaki and Vasudeva were in the prison of Kamsa. So Shri Krishna appears in the four-handed forms and, you know, reveals who he is before he becomes a baby. So similarly, it is said that Sri Ramchandra also reveals his original form to Mother Kaushalya. He actually shows her that he is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And then she asked that, how come you are born from my womb? How come that has happened? So he explained to her that, you know, in your previous lives you had wished, you know, to have me as your son. So I have come here. And after he explains that to her, then he takes away the memory of what he told her. Just like Shri Krishna, when Mother Yashoda asks him to open the mouth and he shows the whole universe in his mouth, and then he takes away that, you know, knowledge that Mother Yashoda got, that this baby is none other than Krishna, because then he will lose that Vatsalya Ras. You know, the Lord enjoys the rasas, like parental love, so he makes her forget. So that's also there. And Ram Katha is never complete without mention of Hanumanji. So whenever there is a Ram Katha, they say Hanumanji is personally present. He comes, people cannot recognize or cannot see him unless you have the divine eyes. And so Ram Katha is never complete without mention of Shri Hanuman. So then, you know, I'm going to make it short. So Shri Ram and, you know, all the four brothers grew up, and as was the custom, they had to go to a Gurukul, Guru Ashram, to get the knowledge. And we all discussed before, if the Lord has to go to get knowledge, then, you know, he's not the Lord, because the Lord has the perfect knowledge. He has the six opulences, and one of that is he's the most knowledgeable. There is no knowledge that escapes the Lord. So why he has to go to Guru to get knowledge? That is to show us by example. So they go to Gurukul of, who was their guru? Like Krishna's guru is? Who? Sandipani. Not Sandipani. Sandipani. Yes. Yes. So the guru of the Ram, Lakshman, Bharat, Shatrughan is Vashishtha Muni. Okay, so they go to the ashram of Vashishtha Muni. He is the kul guru of the Raghu Vansha, and he gives them the training. And not only the training in education, they also, because they are Kshatriyas, get training in warfare. And it is said that Sri Ramchandra is the most expert archer, or Dhanurvidya expert. We know about Arjuna, Karna, there are so many archers, but Sri Ram is the epitome. He is the supreme in the art of archery. So then they get the training, you know, they learn everything very fast, because actually they are the supreme personality of Godhead. So they don't need training, but they go there, they are expert in a very short time. And in a very nice verse in Ramayana, that in a very short time, they get the education and come back. And they say, children, if they recite that verse, they will also advance very fast in their lives. So you can do that. We used to recite when we were children, that verse. So then they come back to the kingdom, and they, you know, they were young. They were like 16 years old. At that time, there is a sage by the name of Vishwamitra. He comes to the court of Dashrath, and that time the sages were highly respected, because they were not imposters, so they were not, you know, they were very elevated personalities. So he comes to Vishwamitra and he needs help, and he asks King Dashrath to give his eldest son for protection, because there were a lot of disturbances happening at that time. The Rakshasas, who were the demons, were disturbing, creating disturbance, and not letting them perform their yagnas. This happened in the Treta Yuga. How many yugas are there in the Vedic system? Four. Very good. So the first one is Satya Yuga, right? Second is Treta, then Dwapar, and then Kali Yuga. We are in the Kali Yuga. So this happened in Treta Yuga. Treta Yuga, the Yuga Dharma was performing elaborate sacrifices, yagnas. That's why you see a lot of, you know, Putra Kameshti Yagna and Ashwamedh Yagna, so many yagnas people performing to get perfection. So they were getting disturbed, so he comes to ask the king to give his son. And Lakshman always wanted to go to wherever Ram was going. He is very close. Although they are born of different mothers, so that's why this dialogue comes, you know, brother from the other mother. No, I'm just kidding. So, but they were very close. So they're brothers from the other mother, but they were very close. And Lakshmana always wanted to accompany Ram, so he also goes. And Dashrath is very sad to, you know, send his children, and they're very young, but he had to oblige the sage and he lets them go. And then we only know that Shri Ram killed Ravana, right? Ravana was very evil and he was very strong. He had his own kingdom. He has so many things that we're going to hear in Dashara time. But he killed many demons when he was young. And this is one of the demons who was disturbing the performance of the sacrifices at that time. And her name is Tadaka. Now you don't have to remember this name. It's not a holy name. So you don't have to, you know, meditate on it. So, but anybody in our childhood who was not nice, we used to call her Tadaka. So, not in front of her, but say, oh, Tadaka. Oh, that Tadaka. Okay, so that was Tadaka. She was very ferocious. And it is said before she was not so ferocious, she was cursed because she did something and she became Tadaka and then she did that. And things are very interrelated. So, Tadaka had sons. One of the sons was Marich, who goes as a golden deer. He was Marich. And also, she had a daughter, her name was Kalineni. She was the mother of Ravana. So it's all interrelated. So that was Tadaka. And nobody could deal with her. So Sri Ramchandra and Lakshmanji, they kill her. And they kill many other demons who are creating disturbance and make that place good for performing devotional service at that time, yagnas. So then I'm going to touch upon a little bit another pastime of Shri Ram. Now they've grown up and a lot of things have happened. So the Ramayana, which is the life story of Shri Ram, was actually written before Shri Ram appeared by Valmiki. We all know Rishi Valmiki was a dacoit, not even a thief, dacoit. He will kill people and rob them. And then with the blessings of Narada Muni, he became an elevated sage. And he wrote Ramayana before appearance of Shri Ram. And so there are seven khand, there are seven chapters or portions of Ramayana. So the Bal khand, and then I'm skipping some, Aranya khand, and then finally Mother Sita is kidnapped, right? Because they took Banvas. Shri Ram was going to be coronated as a king. But then Kaikeyi asked the promise that Dashrath had given her, that he will give her anything she wants, actually two things, and she asked that Shri Ram to go to the forest for 14 years and her son Bharat to be the king. So Shri Ram, you know, agrees to let his father keep his promise. Look at the sacrifice. That's why he's called Maryada Purushottam. In nowadays, I should not give any examples. But if somebody says, you know, somebody's father promised something, he says, oh, that was then, I don't know. Why should I go to the forest, right? But Shri Ram decided to go to forest, and Shri Ram wanted to go to forest, so Mother Sita decided to go to forest, right? And so that's why he's called Maryada Purushottam. So this pastime actually happened with lady named by Ahilya Bai. She was, this episode happens actually before all these things I told about kidnapping of Sita Mata and all. So here Vishwamitra and is going with Shri Ram and Lakshman, because Vishwamitra got an invitation from king of Janakpuri. His name was King Janaka, that he has a daughter eligible to be married. So at those times, when a daughter became eligible to be married, the father will invite eligible young people to come and claim her as their wife. But the choice was with the girl. The girl was not forced to marry anybody by the choice of anybody. She will decide, but then she had to decide from the qualified people, not anybody from the street. Okay? For examples for our young girls. So don't pick up anybody from the street. It has to be qualified, vetted by your parents. You know, background, the family history gets known, and the mental history is known, everything is known. And then the young people are invited, and then the girl is allowed to choose. Okay, now you have this 50 people to choose from. And then that was called swamvar. Swam means yourself, var means your spouse. So choose your spouse yourself, but out of the given choices, not random. So that was the time. So at that swamvar was a very elaborate ceremony. So not only the young eligible men were invited, even the sages and elders, you know, respectable people in the society were invited. That's how the Vedic culture is. The elders and the respected people in the society are respected in that way. And so Vishwamitra was invited. So Vishwamitra said, why don't you also come with me? Because they also actually qualified. They were Kshatriyas, they were princes, and they were educated, they're very handsome, you know. So he said, let's go, we are invited. So they were going on the way and they find this. So this Ahilya Bai had a curse and she had turned into a stone. That was a curse. But then when whatever wrong she did, and then somebody asked, how can she get out of this curse? Because if it's a stone, it'll be forever. So then somebody said that, okay, whoever that Rishi had given the curse, that Shri Ram will come in the Treta Yuga and will liberate you. So they on the way come, and then Shri Ram touches that stone with just his foot, and she is liberated and gets back her original form. And she is very thankful to Shri Ram. And Shri Ram did this because although she committed some offense, she was a devotee, and so she deserved to be liberated. And the connection here now, Ahilya Bai was related to the wansh of Janaka, who was the father of Mother Sita, right? I'm not going to go into the birth of Mother Sita and how, appearance of Mother Sita, how it happened. We'll do that in the later, when the time comes. So when they come, they were like uninvited. Nobody knew, you know, that Ram and Lakshman have come with Vishwamitra. So somebody questioned who they are, and then somebody came and told Janaka, oh, he is actually the personality who liberated our great grandmother Ahilya from, you know, the condition of being a stone. So then they were received very nicely and they came. And the swamvar was on, and we have heard about the swamvar. So I'm going to touch on things that, you know, I found a little interesting for the children and for all ages. So in the swamvara, there is always a contest. So although you come with your reputation, okay, you are a king of so-and-so or you're a prince of so-and-so, but then you have to prove also, you know, to the audience, to the girl who is going to marry you, that you are really worthy of it. So there is always something. We remember, you know, to marry Draupadi, that Arjuna had to shoot the eye of a fish who was turning on a wheel by looking into the reflection in a pond of water. How difficult that is, right? So similarly, in this swamvar, there was a feat to be performed. And the feat was that there was a bow. Yeah. It belonged to Lord Shiva. And Lord Shiva has actually given it to King Janaka. King Janaka was also Shiva Bhakt. So he had that Shiva Dhanush. It's called Dhanush in Sanskrit. Shiva Dhanush at his home in the place where they keep all the weapons, you know, the Kshatriyas. And this did not happen out of the blue or arbitrarily. So the story is that one time Vishwamitra was visiting Lord Janaka in his palace. So while chanting, he was taking a walk in the garden, and he happened to look inside the Shastralaya, you know, that's the arsenal where all the weapons are kept. And he saw that young mother Sita. Now it was a custom, although she is a princess, she had thousands of servants and the dasis and, you know, so many, but they will perform some housework. Okay, children? They will do some housework. They will do dusting, they will cleaning, they will do something. They will not just sit and eat and, you know, watch TV or play games. That was the custom at that time. So she was dusting. And then she wanted to clean behind the weapon. So she picks up the Shiva Dhanusha with one hand and keeps it on the side. So Vishwamitra sees that. He is amazed and he recognizes who she is. So that is the reason he brings Shri Ram to that Swayamvar. Okay, now here is another twist. In that Swayamvar, there was another personality who could also do this feat. What was the feat? The feat was to string the bow. It's called prachand. You know, you have to put that string to the bow. The bow was not stringed when it is not in a fighting mode. But when it goes to the war, because then the string gets loose. So at that time, the bow was stringed and, you know, it's ready to go to war. So that was a feat to be performed. And in none of the kings or the princes in that assembly of the Swamvara could perform that feat except two people. Who was the other person? We all know him. Ravana. Not Lakshman either. Ravana. Ravana was there and he had come there, but he had an agenda. What was the agenda? It is said that Shiva Dhanush was not an ordinary Dhanusha. There are two Dhanusha. There is one Shiva Dhanusha and there is a Vishnu Dhanusha. And they are actually nuclear missile launching weapons. So Ravana had become very strong. He had conquered, you know, many, and he had put devatas in his prison and they were listening to him what to do and what not to do. He wanted not only to marry the most beautiful woman in the whole of creation, not planet, not universe, not Miss World, not Miss Universe, Miss Creation. He also wanted the Dhanusha, because once he had the Dhanusha, nobody could defeat him. So he had double agenda. That's why he had come there. But then he was prevented from doing it. So Shri Ram then comes. Nobody even could come near the Dhanusha. It was so powerful. Nobody could even, whoever could come nearby the king, could not even move it, could not even pick it. They would fall, you know, we do it in the Ram Leela, we do it very nicely, we might do it this year. So then, you know, Vishwamitra tells Shri Ram, you know, why don't you go and do that? So Shri Ramchandra goes and he goes to string that bow. And when he bends the bow, because the bow has to be bent to put the string in a tension, he breaks the bow. He's so powerful. So the second picture is actually drawn under the instructions of Srila Prabhupada. It's an ISKCON drawing. And there it depicts more how powerful that bow is, you know, that nobody could lift it. It's like huge, that Shiva Dhanusha. So he breaks it. And then, of course, you know, he becomes eligible to be married to the most beautiful woman in the whole creation. And I will come to the beauty of Mother Sita later. So there is another very interesting part here. So when that Dhanusha breaks, there is a tumultuous sound, you know, there is a huge sound. Some of the people in that second picture, you know, even are falling, fainting, and, you know, they're distressed because of the sound. The first picture doesn't show that. The first picture is drawn by a very famous scientist, and we all seen, you know, the picture of Lakshmi, and all those pictures are drawn by that famous artist. His name is Raja somebody. And the second one is ISKCON painting. So in that is depicted how everybody was same. The, you know, Narasimha Dev coming out of the pillar. It depicts the emotions of all the people around it. So that sound actually goes very far. How far? It goes up to the Himalayas. And guess who hears it? Huh? Lord Shiva's another bhakta. He is Lord Parshuram. He hears it. And he comes to the arena or the assembly where that samvara was happening. And he comes there and he enters in and he sees the Shiva Dhanusha broken and lying on the ground. So he gets very angry and he asks Maharaj Janak, how this happened? Who broke this Dhanush? So all the assembled Kshatriyas, they're all trembling because, you know, Parshuram, what he did? He eliminated all bad kings, corrupt kings, you know. The current day politicians will all be killed by him if he's there. So he kills them 21 times. He goes all over the earth and kills all the corrupt kings. So they're all traveling and they're all announcing, you know, I'm so-and-so, son of so-and-so, trying to prove their, you know, credentials, and they're giving way to Parshuram to come, and his weapon is the axe. So he comes there, he asks, who did this? So everybody, there's a pin drop silence. And he's very angry. So Lakshman, as we know, Lakshman always gets angry. So Yajat acted as Lakshman, and then Vedant acted as Lakshman. So, you know, always angry mood. So now he knows that, you know, maybe this man in, you know, he had a actually lion's skin on him and, you know, looking very ferocious, might do harm to Shri Ram. So he comes in the way. There's a lot of dialogue goes on. So he says, what is your problem? This dhanush is broken by my great brother Shri Ram. So Parshuram gets very angry because of his arrogance and his anger. So he's ready to attack, and then Shri Ram comes in the middle of Lakshman and Parshuram, and he's all calm and quiet, and he speaks in a very gentle voice and tells that this great feat cannot be done by anybody else except one of your disciples. So when Parshuram hears those words, he calms down. He says, who is this? This guy is so arrogant in this thing, and this guy is so nice. Then again, he says, but how can any of my disciple do such a stupid thing, you know, breaking a Shiva Dhanush? So he again gets angry. Then again, Lakshman comes in the way. And again, he says something. He says, why? Why your disciple cannot do this, and this can happen? Anybody can do it. Because it had to be done to get the hand of the daughter of Maharaj Janak. So again, Parshuram is angry. So this goes on for quite some time. I don't remember the whole sequence. There is a very sweet sequence. Goes on and on and on and on. And then, in the end, Lord Parshuram doesn't believe Lakshmana that Ramchandra has broken that dhanusha. So Parshuram had another dhanusha, which was the Vishnu dhanusha. So he says, okay, if that's the case, if this man has broken, because Shri Ram was appearing so gentle and so nice, he was not that he can do such a thing. He says, okay, then try to string this dhanusha. He gives the Vishnu dhanusha to Shri Ram. So Shri Ram takes the Vishnu. Dhanusha is always actually carried in the left hand. Because right hand you take out the arrow and then shoot. So the dhanusha is always carried. So he takes the dhanusha in the left hand. Because no ordinary soul can even pick it up. So he picks it up, and as he goes to string it, his angocha moves here. And the Shri Vatsa sign that is on the chest of the Lord is exposed. And Parshuram sees it and he recognizes that is Krishna himself. So then he calms down and he, you know, pays his obeisances, and that's how the story goes. So then, you know, Mother Sita is married to Shri Ram, and then this is called the Varmala. So what happens? The girl, whoever she chooses as a var, as spouse, she garlands that person, and then the other Vedic ceremony happens and things like that. So that was something sweet I wanted to share. So I'm going to continue another 10 minutes. So then we can go on and on, but I think we'll cut it short. So then, you know, the marriage happens, then, you know, they come to Ayodhya, and then Sri Ram is to be coronated, which I explained just now, and then they take Vanvas. And when they go to Vanvas, they have to cross the river called Sariu to go to the other side of the forest. And this is a very nice story. So Sri Ram, there's a lot of elaborate boats to cross over because he was the king, he was a prince, he was going to be the king next day when this happened. So he chooses the boat of one person, his name is called Kevat. Kevat actually means the one who steers the boat. So he takes the boat of the Kevat, he tells us to take us across the river. So it's very nicely described in Tulsidas Ramayana. So Kevat takes Sri Ram, Lakshman and Sita across the river, and he sings the glories. And he says that the personality, by taking whose name once, we can cross this ocean, this samsara, this cycle of life, birth, death, you know, disease, old age is called samsara. It's described as an ocean that we are, you know, drowning and swimming in it, can cross by just taking his name once. He's sitting in my boat, and I'm taking him across. And why did Sri Ram do it? Because Kevata was a devotee. Although he came from a very low status, he was very poor, but he got the mercy of Daya Sindhu that Prakash Prabhu just sang. Similarly, we have Boat Leela of Shri Krishna. It's a different mood. So Sri Ram is Maryada Purushottam, very particular, you know, very strict following, and then we have Shri Krishna. So this boat leela also signifies the same thing, that Krishna will take us in the boat across this ocean of suffering, but he takes it in his own style. So that's why he's called Purna Avatar. So I just wanted to mention that there's a boat leela of Krishna and there is a boat leela of Sri Ram. So then the question comes, okay, you know, that Kevata was personally delivered by Sri Ram, because once Sri Ram sat in his boat and made him take him across this river, Kevata is, you know, booked in Vaikuntha. And same is the gopis. Then Krishna is taking them in his boat. So what about us? Right? We have no chance. But that's not true. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave us the clue and the key how we can do it. And that is Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So it is said that one name of Rama, by the way, do we know what the main name Rama means? What Prakash Prabhu is nodding his head. Pleasure, yes. Rama means the reservoir for all pleasure. Actually, it is the origin of all pleasure. All pleasure comes from Rama. Krishna means all attractive. Rama means the origin or the reservoir of pleasure. That's why when they say Ramta Yogi, that means somebody who is immersed in bliss. So that is the meaning of Rama. And it said, Ram Ram Rameti, Ram Rame Manorame, Sasanam Tatulyam, Ram Nam Varanane. So one name of Rama is equal to 1,000 names of Vishnu. So in Vishnu Sasanama, if you are taking Vishnu's name 1,000 times, you take one name of Rama, it's equal to that. And then if you take one name of Krishna, it is equal to the three names of Rama. So in the Mahamantra, you can imagine how many times we say the name of Vishnu. So 1,000, 1,000, 1,000, and then multiplied by 3. That is the power of Mahamantra. That's why it's called Mahamantra. It's the most powerful mantra in this Kali Yuga. So then I will just touch upon the story of Shabri. Shabri was another great devotee of Shri Lord Ram, and she was a queen in the previous life, and then she did something and she was to be born again. She wanted to be a devotee, but she was not allowed to be a devotee. So then she took another birth and became a devotee, but this time she was born in a poor family. So what she did, she could not, because she was born in a woman's body, she could not associate with the sadhus. Because the sadhus, the ascetics, they stay away and they don't do anything with the women. So she will go very early morning before even those sadhus will get up and go. There was a pond. The name of the pond was Pampa. It's a very auspicious pond. She will go and clean the walkway going to the pond, because the sadhus will get up, they'll go and have a bath in the pond, they'll come back and they'll do their paricharya. So she'll do that, and then the chief sadhu over there, I'm forgetting his name, he saw that, you know, this path is always clean in the morning, and who is doing it? So one day he gets up very early and he finds this young lady doing this work. And it is said that she was not very intelligent, but she was performing this service thinking that she'll get some benefit out of it. So then he takes pity on her. He talks to her and she says, you know, she wanted to be a devotee and she wanted to do devotional service. So he makes a small hut outside where all the sages stayed, and she'll stay there. And he took her as his own daughter. And he told her that because of her pure devotional service, Lord Ram will personally come and meet her. But before that could happen, he was old, so he died. And Shabri, after he died, she kept doing the devotional service, and she was doing the devotional service in her own way. She was not very educated, she was not very intelligent. But what she will do is, she will go to the forest and collect flowers and fruits and keep it waiting for Shri Ram to come. That when he comes, she will offer the flowers and the fruits to him, because there's nothing else in the jungle. But as it is, Shri Ram will not come, then in the evening after sundown, she will eat those flowers and then wait for the next day. That's how she spent her life. So it is said that when they were searching for Mother Sita, they actually come to that place called the Pampa Pond, and there were a lot of sages living in that area. Everybody was inviting them to come to their hermitage, but Shri Ram chooses to go to the small hut of Shabri. And it is described that when Shabri sees Shri Ram, how she celebrates. She sings, she dances, she does kirtan, and she's so flabbergasted, she doesn't know how to welcome them. So she makes Shri Ram sit on the ground. She puts a mat and makes it put on the ground, although there were some chairs lying there, some place to sit. So Lakshmanji gets very angry as usual. So he's looking at her, what is this old woman is doing, because she was old, disheveled at that time. And then she offers the flowers, and then she had collected some berries that day, and she wanted to give it to Shri Ram. So what she was doing it, she was picking up one berry from her basket, eating half of it, and then throwing some and giving some to Shri Ram. So then Lakshmanji get really mad. So then she says, what is this? You are giving, jutha, what you have eaten, the remnant of your to my elder brother. So then Shri Ram tells him to calm down. And she explains that she's tasting those berries and making sure that they're sweet and fit for me to eat before she gives it to me. So that is her bhav. So don't get angry. She is a very elevated devotee. So it is described by this pastime that you don't have to be very rich, you don't have to be very learned, you don't have to be performing very elaborated, you know, paricharyas to get the mercy of Lord. You can be poor, you can be light-headed, you can be simple, and you can get the mercy of Shri Ram. That is the lesson we get from this story. And then there was a little more story. There was a pond. That pond, actually, one time Shabri was cleaning those pathway. So one of the sages was touched by the broom that she was sweeping with, and he gets very angry and he yells at Shabri, can't you see you're touching me with this dirty broom and this and that? And then when he goes into that pond, which was like, you know, the pond in Kurukshetra is a very auspicious pond, he enters the pond water turns red and becomes polluted by the sage entering the pond. So that pond was not in use. So then Shri Ram tells Shabri to, you know, put her feet in the pond. So as soon as she puts her feet in the pond becomes crystal clear again and becomes eligible to be used again. So that is very nice story. There are some more innuendos in this story that I'm not going to go into. And then at that time, Shri Ram gave instructions to Lakshman, because Lakshman is so angry at Shabri. And it's the same that the Prahlad Maharaj gave us, the Navvidha Bhakti, but it's a little different. It's more to how to become a devotee. So there are 9 ways to increase our love for God. So these instructions actually given to Lakshmana by Shri Ramchandra. That to have the company of saints and devotees. You know, Sadhu Sangha we talk about. That same thing Shri Ram is telling. That you should always have company of saints and the devotees. Love and interest in the stories and leelas of God. Just like we are sitting here listening to Ram Katha. That should be aim of our life. Whenever we get time to listen and join the Ram Katha or Krishna Katha. Humble service in the holy feet of the spiritual master. You know, accept a bona fide spiritual master and serve him. That's instruction coming from Shri Ram. Leave deceit and dishonesty and sing the glory of God. Just like what Shabri did. She was very simple hearted. She didn't want anything. She just wanted to serve. Have firm faith in God and chant his holy names. What she did. Every day she'll collect flowers and fruits and wait whole day for years and years. Control of the senses, dispassion, adopt the path of righteousness, dharma, and have a good character. What Shabri, you know, demonstrated to us. See God everywhere and give due respect to the saints. That's what Shabri did. Be satisfied with whatever you have and never find fault with others. You know, don't criticize, don't find faults. Adopt simple and non-deceitful nature. Have firm faith in God. Be balanced, neither happy nor sad. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita 2, be sthit pragna. Always be stable, level-minded, whether you face a difficulty or you win a lottery. Always be grounded. Always thank Krishna for whatever comes. If something bad comes, think something worse had to come, but you got away lightly. If something big comes, it comes from Krishna. That should be our mood. So that's the instructions given to Lakshmana by Shri Ram after meeting Shabri. So now I'm going to touch upon something that's very interesting. I came across. The children, do you see that form on the left-hand side? So you guys play video games, you watch cartoons, right? A lot of monsters and scary characters, right? Guess how scary this character is. And this one is from our scriptures. Now this is a tough one. Surabhi, do you know who this is? This is a really tough one, so I shouldn't be asking you. Okay, so this is one of the demons that Ram and Lakshman, you see, they are Ram and Lakshman in the forest clothes. The name of this demon is Kabandha. See, he has only mouth, he had long arms, and he had... Yes. Exactly. So he had no head. So the story is, this long story, he got into a fight with Indra, and Indra hit him with a vajra and drove his head into his stomach. So, but all he could do was eat. He would eat anything and anybody that passes by and grab with his long arm. And because he asked a boon, how will I survive? You know, I want to live. So his mouth came out of his stomach, and that's how it looked. And then actually he was liberated. You know, when Krishna or Rama killed somebody, they get liberated. So he was killed by cutting his arms and this. And he's the one actually who tells, Surabhi, are you listening? Where is Surabhi? So he's the one actually who tells Shri Ram to go to place where Sugriva was, to meet Sugriva, to get his help, to fight Ravana. What was that place where Sugriva lived? No, the questions are for small children. Kishkindha, right, absolutely. So that's the place, he is the one who tells to go there. And do you know why Lord Rama went to the monkeys and the, what are those, bears to fight? Nobody knows this, right? We all think, oh, it's all made up, how the monkeys fight and this, and why did he not get help from anybody else? So, no. One of the stringent rules in the Vanvas is that you will, for 14 years, not even go near a human inhabitation. Absolutely. You cannot even enter a village or a city or a town. So then, if that's its condition, how you get help from anybody except the people who live in the forest? And who lives in the forest? The animals. So that is the reason why Sri Rama took help from monkeys and bears and squirrels and other animals to fulfill all conditions, because he is Maryada Purushottam. So when the contract is signed, no way going here and there. Full 14 years he maintained it. And it's very tough to do that. So that's why Sri Ram is known as Maryada Purushottam. Ideal son, ideal king, ideal father, ideal, you know, whatever, in whatever angle you see from. So that is the, you know, beauty of our scriptures. So if you think of, you know, demons, fights, everything is given. And all these things, you know, like the superhero of today, the Superman, you know, when I was small, we'll read Superman, so fascinated with Superman because he could fly. But guess, Hanumanji flew in Treta Yuga. And he did not carry a kryptonite. He carried a mountain, right? So who can compare to Hanumanji as Superman? Of, you know, somebody's conception. Actually, they borrowed a lot of things from the Vedic scriptures, if you go. So that with that, we will end our lecture. Ram, Ram, Rameti, Rame, Rame, Manorame, Sasranam, Tattulyam, Rama, Nam, Varanane. By meditating on Rama, 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 the name of Rama, my mind gets absorbed in the divine consciousness of Rama, which is transcendental. The name of Rama is as great as the 1,000 names of God, Vishnu Sahasranama. And remembering my father, he always chanted Ram, 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 Ram. So, with that, I end today's presentation. Thank you very much for listening. We'll do Kirtan and do Aarti and Pushpabhishekam, and then we'll have Prashadam. Any questions or any additions you can say now? I hope, children, you enjoyed it. Surabhi, did you learn anything new?